Welcome, everyone. This webinar will take you through our latest threat report summarizing the findings of ESET research in the last 4 months of 2022. My name is Robert Lipovsky, and I work for ESET as a principal threat intelligence researcher. And today I'll be presenting with my colleague Ondrej Kubovic, who is a security awareness specialist and also one of the writers of this report. As always, let's begin with the featured story. In T3, ESET published research into a spear phishing campaign by Mirrorface, which is a Chinese-speaking threat actor targeting media, defense-related companies, think tanks, diplomatic organizations, and academic institutions based in Japan. The goal of Mirrorface is espionage and exfiltrations of files of interest to the attackers. Just weeks before the Japanese House of Counselors election in July 2022, we noticed a spear phishing campaign targeting candidates in that election, a malicious campaign which we named Operation Liberal Face. Our investigation revealed that the members of one specific political party were of particular focus of the threat actors. One of the malicious spear phishing emails posed as an official communication from the PR department of this party, asking the recipients to distribute the attached files. The provided content was videos with various topics that candidates were supposed to post on social media profiles to further strengthen the party's PR. And it also contains some further instructions on how to post them. The email contained a malicious attachment, in this case, a self-extracting RAR archive. And it had these file names, which translated via machine translators, you can see on this slide. In the first file, the President Kishida request and so on, the attackers referred to Fumio Kishida, the Japanese prime minister and the president of the targeted party. The second file name, as you can see, is much more generic. If executed, the attachment opened a decoy document and ran a legitimate application that dropped the load info backdoor and its components. This malware is known since December 2019, and it allows the attackers to capture screenshots, log keystrokes, kill processes, exfiltrate files, and execute additional files and commands. In this campaign, our research also spotted a new, previously undocumented malware, which we named Mirror Stealer. This was used to pilfer its target's credentials from various applications such as browsers and email clients. Interestingly, one of the targeted applications was Becky, an email client currently available only in Japan. Now, since Mirror Stealer doesn't have the capability to actually exfiltrate the stolen data, it depends on other malware to do that. We attribute Operation Liberal Face to Mirrorface based on the following indicators. First, to the best of our knowledge, load info malware is exclusively used by Mirrorface. Also, the targets of Operation Liberal Face align with usual Mirrorface targeting. And a second stage load info malware sample contacted a command and control server that we tracked internally as part of Mirrorface infrastructure. Moving on to the research news we published in T3. ESET research discovered a Linux variant of the Sidewalk backdoor, one of the multiple custom implants used by the Sparking Goblin APT group. Now, Sparking Goblin targets mostly East and Southeast Asia with a particular focus on the academic sector. We first saw the Linux variant of Sidewalk in action in February 2021, when it was deployed against a Hong Kong university that had already been targeted by Sparking Goblin in the past. The Linux variant of Sidewalk exhibits several similarities to its Windows counterpart, but also some technical novelties. The similarities include the same customized ChaCha20 encryption algorithm, software architecture, configuration, and the implementation of the dedrop resolver. As for differences, the Linux variant contains debugging symbols and leaves some unique authentication keys and other artifacts unencrypted, which makes the detection and analysis significantly easier. ESET researchers have also found an updated version of a tool used by the Sandworm APT, the threat actor attributed to the Russian Military Intelligence Service, GRU, and tied to dangerous cyber attacks, including disruptions to the Ukrainian power grid and the destructive NotPetya outbreak. In November 2022, we detected in Ukraine new ransomware written in .NET that we named RansomBogs. Now, the ransomware had multiple references to the Monsters, Inc. film. It was used as a data wiper, as its operators had no intention to help victims recover and decrypt files, nor did they demand a ransom. Even though it was new, the way it was deployed was very similar to some past attacks attributed to Sandworm. So RansomBogs was distributed from the victim's domain controllers through a PowerShell script that was almost identical to the one used in both the CaddyWiper and InDestroyer 2 attacks in Ukraine, both of which were carried out by Sandworm. And in almost all of the wiper cases that we've attributed to Sandworm, including RansomBogs, the Active Directory group policy was abused. ESET researchers also discovered a campaign conducted by the Bahamut APT group that targeted Android users. This group is known since 2017 and typically targets entities and individuals in the Middle East and South Asia with spear phishing and fake applications. Bahamut specializes in cyber espionage, and we believe that its goal is to steal sensitive information from its victims. The recently discovered campaigns was active since January 2022, distributing at least 8 Trojanized versions of 2 legitimate VPN apps through a fake secure VPN website. Now, although the malware employed throughout this campaign uses the name SecureVPN, it has no association whatsoever with the legitimate multi-platform SecureVPN software and service. We found at least 8 versions of the Bahamut spyware. Bahamut's spyware is able to exfiltrate sensitive data like contacts, SMS messages, call logs, the device location, and recorded phone calls. It can also actively spy on chat messages exchanged through very popular messaging apps, including Signal, Viber, WhatsApp, Telegram, and Facebook Messenger. We found that the spyware code, and hence its functionality, is the same as in previous Bahamut Android campaigns, including storing data in a local database before exfiltrating it to the operator's servers, which is a tactic rarely seen in mobile cyber espionage apps.
Thank you, Robert. In the next section, we'll take the high-level overview of the threat landscape that we have seen in T3, starting with the geographic distribution. If you would look at the map, the top 3 targeted countries were Japan, followed by Spain and Turkey, which is the same top 3 that we have seen in T2 and also throughout the whole of 2022. Now, in the last 4 months of 2022, it was very similar to T2 and was marked by a general decrease across the threat landscape. Our telemetry registered a 13.2% reduction in the threat detections, and there was only one small spike mid-September caused by an increased activity of HTML phishing.agent. However, the data for the whole year shows a completely different story, as there has been increase in the overall threat detections, and it has been going up by 13% year over year. This is interesting to see because this is a trend that we have observed also in some other smaller categories in our telemetry. For example, we have seen the same thing happening in downloaders and email threats. And if we tweak the methodology a little bit, also info stealers. We have to add that in case of info stealers, it was a similar development because the whole category was going down by 13%, but the banking malware was growing by 108%. So just a subcategory of this whole section was going up, and it was mostly caused by Magecart, which is a notoriously known web skimmer that was infiltrating e-commerce websites and stealing credit card details. Now, there was one category that thrived throughout the whole year, and that was Android threats. It has registered a remarkable growth in the last 4 months. It grew by 57%, which is a significant acceleration when we compare it to the 5 and 10% increases seen in T1 and T2. Now, what was behind the growth? It was mostly increase in adware and hidden apps. We're gonna delve into that later on in this presentation. So much for the bird eye view of the threat landscape. Now let's zoom in on ransomware, because that's the category that everybody's interested in always, and it was quite destructive in T3. So let's look at that a little bit. In the last few years, ransomware was mostly known because the threat actors have been using it for its extreme profitability. One attack could have brought them millions of dollars in Bitcoin. Now, that has changed a little bit, especially since the Russian invasion of Ukraine, and it continues to showcase its destructive potential. So the ransomware has been used not to extort money from the victims, it was used to destroy the data of the victims by encrypting it. Of course, the attackers had zero intention to help the victim to recover. Just in T3, ESET described several instances of ransomware-looking wipers, and we are not even naming all of them in this table that you can see. Most of them were seen in Ukraine. There was also this one case called Prestige ransomware, where the attacks spilled over also to Poland, and there was one family that targeted data of Russian institutions called CryWiper. In the APT section, we described RansomBox, so we won't focus on that one now, but we'll delve into the Somnia Wiper, which is another instance of ransomware that was actually wiping the data of its victims. Our analysis shows that it used to drop three different files. One was text.exe, the second one funnysomnia.exe, and image.bmp. What's interesting and a little bit surprising, the most innocuous looking text.exe is the actual wiper, and funnysomnia.exe is executed after the encryption is finished, displaying a ransom note. The image.bmp is the last file that we have seen, and it is used as, or may be used as, the background image of victim's machine, and it displays the logo of the group that has been that this attack has been attributed to by CertUA, namely from Russia with love. Also interesting, what you can see in the picture, the image contains the letter Z, a symbol of Russian aggression against its Western neighbor. As for the general trends in ransomware category, the number of detections remained steady in T3, dropping only by 2% compared to T2. The year-over-year detection trend was considerably more dynamic, and it went down by 20% between 21 and 22. Several factors could have probably contributed to the drop, and this includes the increased activity of law enforcement and coordination, international coordination. Also, disruptions that were caused by the war in Ukraine might have had an impact, and also increased regulation that is limiting ransom payments could have led to diminished financial returns for the attackers and thus less activity or lower ransom demands. We also have to say this statistics is showing mostly the mass spread ransomware attacks. So these campaigns are being spread via email or similar vectors, and most of the targeted ransomware attacks are not included in this statistic. The geographical distribution of ransomware shows that the threats were shifting towards east. China saw the largest number of incidents. The second most frequently hit was the United States, followed by Russia, Ukraine, and Japan. The yearly data shows that Russia was in the lead with 8% of the attacks, followed by the second place the US, which faced only 7% of the attacks, and Ukraine was fourth with less than 4% of 2022 ransomware attacks. Now, the potentially astronomic incomes that I have been talking about before still work like a magnet for criminals. This leads to a number of new ransomware families that are being kickstarted every 4 months, and this is also true for the T3. The list includes, for example, the doppelganger of Conti, which is now a defunct ransomware family called Monty, very creative, or a new variant of Mount Locker called Dagon Locker. The last 4 months also brought some good news. Probably very happy are going to be the victims of LockerGoga, Ranhasan, and Zeppelin ransomware families, which all have a decryptor now. The Dutch police was also quite skillful, and they showed that they are able to trick the attackers, trick the tricksters if you want, and together with a partner from private sector, they were able to lure out decryption keys from NAS targeting gang called Deadbolt. Through this action, they were able to help as many as 90% of the Dutch victims who have reported the crime to the authorities. So if they didn't, they were not on the list. But probably the best piece of news arrived few weeks after the end of T3. It was on January 26th when agencies from the United States and EU announced that they seized Hive's Tor landing page and also that they had access to its systems since July 2022, so for a few months already. This access allowed the agents to get their hands on decryption keys for all the victims, and this is all together for about 1,500 victims out there, which saves them around $130 million in ransom payments. Good job. In the APT universe, planting a false flag or false evidence that points to other threat actors is quite a common strategy, but in the crimeware arena, we don't see this as much. And Jan Lawang was lucky enough to see a leak of their files, and this leak contains a lot of information about the gang, for example, the aliases of core members, internal chats, and also the information from the leak site. And digging through that, researchers were able to find that its operators spoke almost perfect Russian, so it's probably not China-aligned as we previously thought, based on the name. And if we look at the amount of the, and also the type of leaked data, it means that this gang is probably going to bite the dust after the leak. Of course, if the attackers aren't arrested, it's a high probability that they will come back. Okay, so enough about ransomware. Let's talk a little bit about the network intrusion vectors or exploits that are being used by the attackers. So one trend that we have already described and we have been following on since beginning of 2022 was that the number of RDP attacks was going down. In 2021, it was completely opposite. It was constantly growing, and it was altogether 288 attack attempts that we have blocked in 2021. Now in 2022, the first 10 days were also detection heavy, but after that, there was a nosedive drop. And this rapid decline has continued until May 2022, when the figures mostly stabilized and kept going down only slowly. In T3, we have seen the figures drop by 16%. Looking at the absolute numbers of these attacks, the block number of password guesses went from over 1 billion in T1 to 105 million in T2 and 89 million in T3. Statistically speaking, the number of password guesses has dropped year over year by 49%, going from those 288 billion that I mentioned in 2021 to less than 146 billion in 2022. If you take out the first 10 detection heavy days, the drop would be even more dramatic, reaching as much as 63%. As for factors that might have contributed to this major trend change, we stand by our hypothesis from previous threat report, and that is the declining remote work, improved setup and countermeasures used by company IT departments, also disruption due to war in Ukraine, which is probably the most influential factor. The brute force lockout feature will also make a quite big difference in the RDP and other password guessing attacks. The brute force feature that has been added to Windows 11, but also to the older instances of supported operating systems by Microsoft. So this is probably going to make some dents in the activity. From the geographical point of view, Russian IPs were the leading attackers in T3 with 32%, followed by the United States with 10% and IPs in or from an unknown region with 7%. In the yearly perspective, as many as 55% of the attacks originated from Russian IP addresses, so more than a half came from that region. As for the most prominent targets of RDP attacks or password guessing, US had to withstand the most attacks with 11%, followed by Poland with 10%, then Spain with 8%. That's the top three. In the whole of 2022, French, Spanish, and German IPs were the most targeted, but we need to stress that the targets and the attackers, the statistics both, were probably influenced by VPNs, server rentals, proxy services, because it's hard to say if something is coming from that IP originally or if that was just a proxy that led that attack from somewhere else. Just for context, we have to also mention the attacks against public-facing SQL services and SMB services. And if you look at the chart, you can see that SQL followed similar trajectory as RDPs. But in T3, they were going actually up by 10%, so these two seem to be separated now. SMB kept a steady pace throughout the year, declining only by small bits every 4 months. Regarding the most exploited network attack vectors, not much has changed in the last 4 months of 2022. What is still notable is that Log4j declined 2 percentage points, but the number of absolute detections actually grew by 9% when compared to T2, so the absolute numbers are going up. What's behind the increase, or what might actually make the situation with Log4j worse, is the fact that reports show that over 25% of new Log4j library downloads still are of the vulnerable instances. But it's not just desktops and notebooks that the attackers want to attack, and this has been confirmed by the 2022 ESET telemetry data, especially if you look at Android. This was the only category that saw growth in overall numbers of detections throughout the year, and as I already mentioned in the beginning, it bumped up by 57%, 56.5 if you want to be exact, with adware and hidden apps being responsible for the biggest share of this growth. Even though towards the end of December the trend chart showed a decrease, adware still grew significantly over the last 4 months of 2022, and they have added as much as 163% new detections. Now, what were the biggest contributors to the increase? If you look at the top 10, you can see that, for example, Fiben PUA detection grew by 1,100% compared with T2. It represents mostly mobile game apps that are especially hot goods in the pre-Christmas season, which T3 is the whole pre-Christmas season. And one thing that we need to add, developers might want to release their new versions of their games or new games in this season, but the problem is they won't release it everywhere at the same time. So some of the markets are still forced to download the game from unofficial stores, unofficial websites, and this means they can be bundled with malware or some malicious content. Asset telemetry shows that most Fiben detections were seen in Ukraine, Mexico, Brazil, Russia, and Turkey. While Android spyware saw triple-digit growth throughout 2022, T3 was much, much slower because it just went up by 15%, with the most prevalent detection representing this type of malware in the top 10 by Android spy.agent, which had one very interesting variant that I'm going to delve into. It was detected by our systems as variant android/spy.agent.boc, and it was a new occurrence of Android remote access Trojan known as Zimperium. It was spread via Facebook page linking to a website, and this website exactly was distributing the malware that was attacking its victims, trying to exfiltrate their SMS messages, call logs, contact lists, photos. It could even record phone calls and use the compromised device to take pictures. What they used as the lure was the FIFA World Cup 2022 in Qatar. And it's interesting to see that the application that the victim downloaded was actually providing live broadcasts and news from other sources, but it was also doing all the spy work in the background. In T3, we have also identified a malicious Android app that was part of a campaign by Strong Pity APT Group, and it was distributed as a Trojanized version of Telegram chat through a fake Shaggle website. If you don't know Shaggle, it's a legitimate random video chat service. It provides you with an encrypted communication between strangers, so it will connect you to somebody you don't know, but in a safe manner. It's completely web-based, so the genuine site doesn't have a mobile app that you could download and use. On the contrary, the copycat by StrongPD, the website looked very similar, but it was using Trojanized chat app and it had no web-based streaming or other web-based services. How did we arrive at that attribution to StrongPD? We looked at the code and we found out that the code signing certificate was used also in a previous campaign by StrongPity, which was using a Trojanized Syrian e-government app from 2021. It was also using the same obfuscated class names, and they were generated in the same manner. Also, there were some code overlaps and similar functions that were used in this quite simple but very powerful backdoor. So yeah, we are pretty sure it was StrongPity. Now we'll zoom in a little closer at one more category, and that's namely IoT security. In T3 2022, one of the probably most prominent botnets that we have been following, ZHTrap, suddenly closed shop. Our telemetry shows that in the last 4 months, the number of new bots and attacks went down by 97%, so it basically disappeared from our radar. And despite no takedown being reported, its detections fell from tens of thousands in T1 and T2 to almost zero in T3, causing it to basically die in front of our eyes. What's also good to mention, the number of payload servers went down by almost half, 42% if we want to be exact, and it will probably go down even further if the number of attacks doesn't pick up. Now that swift end of ZHTrap contrasts with the almost glacial decline of another player in the botnet area, and that's MozyBotnet. This was once a prime threat for IoT devices. However, after its creators were arrested by Chinese authorities in 2021, it ran on autopilot. Based on our statistics, it seemed like it has been spreading to hundreds of thousands of new devices throughout the year. And while that remains true, also in D3, the numbers were going down significantly. As you can see from the chart, it was dropping by 25% in the last 4 months of 2022. But for now, the zombie botnet still looks very hungry. And without its operators, there is no one to point it at fresh brains. So that's probably why it still bites in the same areas as it did before. And that's almost exclusively in China and India, where 45 and 42% of the new bots were detected. Of its 2.8 million attacks in T3, 30% were aimed at the United States, 6.5% at Germany, and 6% at the UK, which are almost identical figures as seen in T2, which also points to the autopilot operation. Unfortunately, not all IoT botnets go down that easily without much fuss. A case in point are the Mirai-based botnets that we are following. In this category, we are grouping all the Mirai-based botnets using the years-old malware that has been leaked to the internet. In ESET telemetry, this group includes Gavkit, Botenago, Doflu, Tsunami, and we recently also added Zero. The number of devices that were turned into bots by this type of malware grew in T3 by 11%, and it added 200,000 new devices into the botnets. Now, it seems that the attackers found the most fertile ground in Egypt, where two-thirds of new bots were detected. As for the geolocation of its targets, the enslaved IoT devices aimed at 83,000 IP addresses, 20% drop if you compare it with T2, and most of them were in Germany and the United States. However, if we look at the absolute number of attacks, the biggest waves were seen in the United States, and almost a quarter of them made landfall in this country. The good news is that the overall 11 million detections that were seen in connection with Mirai-based botnets mean a 6% drop in activity in T3. So they grew, but they were less active. The end of the year brought also several ethical car hacks. So these were reports showing that smart cars can be hacked. Some of the brands that were impacted, you can see on the screen. All of these brands were vulnerable to attacks that could lock or unlock their doors. The attackers could actually start their engines or take control over their features, such as the horn or headlights. Now, some people will say, okay, but this is all theoretical work and there is no practical end to this. And that is not true. It's nicely demonstrated by a mass arrest of 31 suspects in a Europe-wide bust, which was done by Europol. And these suspects were arrested in connection with car stealing. So this was a gang that was working across Europe, and the criminal ring actually exploited vulnerable keyless entry and start systems to get into the cars and drive them away. So this was really happening in the wild.
In this last part of our webinar, we'll give you a small taste of interesting news from the other categories and also invite you to a few of our talks. Although the crimeware part of cybercurrency-related threats appears to be way past its prime, cryptocurrency scams are gaining in popularity. The FBI issued a warning about so-called pig-butchering crypto investment scams. These schemes involve the fraudster gaining the victim's trust, the victim being the pig in this metaphor, and then enticing them into making regular deposits into crypto investment accounts. The victims can usually track their investments on fake websites and apps that display an illusion of growth. The operators would then later proceed to the butchering part, which means cutting contact with the victim and, as you can probably guess, disappearing with their cryptocurrency. In the downloaders category, the most noteworthy development in T3 2022 was that Emotet operators toned down their activities, running only one campaign at the beginning of November, primarily in Japan. Despite this decrease in activity, there was a new Emotet module added called HW Info. This new component is designed to harvest specific information about the compromised device, enabling Emotet operators to vet the potential bot candidate before delivering another data harvesting module called System Info. And only if both modules return satisfactory data, let's say, would other Emotet modules be downloaded. Based on the gathered information, the botnet operators can this way be more precise in victim targeting and improve their detection of bots planted by security researchers. In the final months of 2022, ESET researchers presented their findings at the AVAR conference in Singapore, or you may have seen my talk at Echo Party in Buenos Aires. For upcoming conference talks, we will be present at RSA in San Francisco and at BotConf in Strasbourg, both conferences being in April. So that's all for our overview. Naturally, this webinar could not possibly cover everything we wrote in the latest threat report. So if any of these topics that we have in the document pique your interest, then I do suggest that you head to the full thing and read more in detail. Also, for your daily portion of ESET research, do visit the research section of welivesecurity.com and follow our Twitter account at ESET Research. Thank you for your attention. If you wish to contact us personally, you can do so through our Twitter accounts. Stay healthy and stay safe.